Clerk to join us and say the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, for being here. And as always, we'll start with public comment number one. Who, if you would like to come up and tell us what's on your mind about what's on today's agenda or anything else? Seeing no one come up, we're gonna move on. And the next item is we're gonna have a dinner report from the ACPC. So come on up, Elizabeth, I'm looking forward to this. Hello.
My name is Elizabeth Meyer. This is my first annual report because I was at a conference last year, so I'm saying the question. So I'm very happy to be here. ACPC has been working through an asset process for some time. We use our funding to provide slight fee scale assistance to parents. Right now, we have about 400 children in our programs, ages 18 months through 12 years. About 100 of those are at the main center. Seven sites throughout Ames, one in each of the elementary schools, and an extra one for the middle schools. Right now, about 32% of the children in our preschool program, and about 68% of our school age program. So 10% of our school age families and 28% of our preschool families utilize the sliding fee scale. Right now, in our preschool program, we are working off of a wait list for the sliding fee scale. Part of that is due to the adjusted structure. Previously, before this year, we had just one reduced tuition. So you either pay full tuition or you qualify for the reduced tuition. But this year we have about five different payments that they can make, depending on their family size and income. And that's just kind of been, we're trying to figure out the best way to do that to serve most families. And our school aid program, we are still able to accept families through the asset funds. So right now, about roughly 90% of our families reside inside of the Ames school district, so about 10% outside. Almost all of those, obviously, are in our preschool program. We have 27 full-time staff and about 75 part-time staff, which is up quite a bit from last year. And that's due to the fact that our school aid program is growing. We have the opportunity to grow exponentially in each of the programs. We could take as many as 100 more students, which is fantastic because we have a lot of students on our wait list. And the biggest barrier that we've been running into lately, and this is not recent, is the staffing. Just trying to find those quality staff to work with after school children, both due to the scheduling and the low unemployment rate. It's been a little bit tricky, but we hope to find them soon. And we are trying to build that opportunity as well. So we see our ability to serve the families of Story County as one of the advantages at the base of the ACPC community. We do have in our preschool program families from pretty much every town in Story County. We also have different field trips. Our children go out and about a lot. If you've been in Ames, you've probably seen us walking around or taking the subway, but also you might have seen our ACPC vans traveling around. They're hard to miss. They're big and white and have a lot on the side. We travel all around Story County and even sometimes to Des Moines to take advantage of all the things that we have to offer. Last year we wrapped up a very large HVAC project. We renovated our entire system. It cost just a little bit more than $1 million, which for an early childhood program is a large bill. So that's something that we are kind of working with right now. And another addition to our older building is that we are currently renovating our fire system. It was original to the building and therefore has some updates to be made. So we are happy to be almost done with that project. And that came in a little bit under at just $75,000. So that's a much cheaper project for us. So right now, we are working to increase the capacity of our school age and the increased capacity at school age, also increasing our capacity at the main center. We have an empty classroom, which we hope to utilize very soon for a toddler or infant population, because that is the age group that has the longest wait list, and we hope to serve them very soon. So as I said, with the wait list, almost all of our programs have one, with the exception being pre-K right now has a couple of openings, and then Mitchell, for whatever reason, MC is a tend to have some openings as well.
Supervisor Brickett, do you have any questions?
No, I don't.
Okay. I do have one. Because your program has been so successful, and you've got this wait list of 100, what capacity challenges will you face, and will you need another building just for your core all-day daycare at some point?
It is very possible that we could need additional space for our, especially the toddler and twos program. The need in Story County continues to grow, and there are other options sometimes can be very costly or maybe of a different quality, and so we definitely have the opportunity to grow. As we talked about, as I said before, we only have one extra classroom right now.
Okay. Has the board talked about maybe building more?
We have talked about it. We have a large green space in the back for those of you that have been to the building, so that's something that we've talked about, but right now I think we're just focusing on the school age portion, and then hoping, because as some of you might know, the toddler programs tend to run at a loss. And so in order to have continued funding for that, the school age program kind of funds the toddler program. And so if we can grow one, we can grow the other.
Thank you. I just know there are discussions going on about how we're going to get our childcare.
Absolutely.
I've been noticing a very long wait list. Do you have any idea what your average wait is?
It's really hard to say. It depends on the age group and when the family gets on. I know some people call us when they find out that they're pregnant, and we don't start until 18 months. And so that's been a fun game to play with families who have been waiting on the list for, you know, 2 years, and trying to figure out that. But some people can wait as little as 6 months, or a pre-user could call today and say, you know, we'd like a space for our child, and we happen to take them next week.
Thank you. Good job on your first report.
Well, thank you. Okay.
All right. We'll go back and have fun playing with the kids.
Thank you.
Let's move on to the consideration of minutes.
I move approval of February 26th minutes.
I would second. Birkin?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
We'll go to consideration of personnel actions.
I would move approval of the personnel actions as listed.
I second.
Supervisor Brickett?
Aye.
Supervisor Olson?
Aye.
Consideration of claims?
No consideration as listed.
Second.
Brickett?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
On the consent agenda, I would like to pull out consent item 6. For separate, just comment for comment. And I would take a motion on everything but item 6.
I will move approval of consent agenda with the exception of item 6.
Second.
Merkin?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
I would just like to comment that item number 6 is consideration of Story County Sheriff giving Wayne Selig a conditional offer of employment as a deputy sheriff. And I want to thank Sheriff Paul Fitzgerald for being very proactive in this and pointing out that Mr. Sell, soon to be Deputy Sell, I assume, started the process over 2 years ago. Application has gone through everything. And then somewhere along the way, married Sheriff Fitzgerald's daughter. And as a result, we want to be very open and above board. And the sheriff has been very proactive in talking to HR, talking to our county attorney, and letting everyone know about this arrangement. And we want to be very transparent about it. And because of the familial relationship, the board has to approve this. So that's my only comment. If anybody else wants to comment, they may, but otherwise, then I take a motion.
I Well, I would also comment that I did meet with the sheriff and meet with County Attorney Reynolds, and I think it is important that we look at this because it is an issue. There is statute, but the county attorney and HR explained to us that the county supervisors have the authority to approve this. And the integrity of the sheriff's office is very important, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk about that and this issue. And I do know and I have faith that that this issue will be handled with integrity and accountability to taxpayers. So I would move approval, which is aye.
And I second.
Merkin?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Thank you. We now move on to public hearing items. And item number one and only item for public hearing today is consideration of resolution 1993 expressing intent to enter into a loan agreement and providing for the levy of taxes to enter into a loan agreement and borrow money for the essential county purpose of constructing, reconstructing, improving, or repairing county bridges, roads, and culverts in an amount not to exceed $8 million. That will assist in economic development. And joining us today is Auditor Lucy Martin, Deputy Auditor Lisa Markley, and Robert Johnston from the Dorsey and Whitney Law.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, I won't repeat what you just summed it up, but we do have Bob Johnston here, Dorsey and Whitney, and prepared the documents. This has already been built into the proposed budget, which will be considered next week. And this basically sets the stage for the county to be able to borrow up to $8 million for essential county purpose for roads. And there's a list of projects was published with the notice of public hearing, and those have all been gone over with the county engineer. Johnston, who's our bond counsel.
Mm-hmm. Are you going to convene a public hearing first?
Yeah, no, but I would like to ask a question first, okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And could either of you help the public understand why we haven't taken this out for a vote, why we're not putting it to the people for a vote, the difference here between this and maybe some other federal?
Sure. The county is using a statute and authorizes all counties in the state to borrow money for roads, provided there's a nexus of economic development. Cities, on the other hand, have what's called an essential corporate purpose, flat-out ability to pave streets, take care of roads. Counties' authority to use and borrow money for roads is different in that it needs to have some relationship, and the board needs to find that there's a relationship between the projects and what this says, assisted economic development that creates jobs and wealth. And that's why there's no requirement for a referendum on this particular bond issue.
Thank you for that.
Yes.
Now I would open the public hearing. Anyone who'd like to speak, please come forward. And seeing no one get up and speaking, I will close the public hearing.
And I would just ask Laura, there were no submitted written comments?
There were none to Laura, to me as chair. Supervisor Merkin, did you get any?
Pursuant to state law, and this hearing and the approval of makes it possible to legally include this debt service, what's called a debt service tax in the budget, as the Honorable mentioned. Without this particular hearing resolution, there would not have been the power to include that in the budget. That's why it's important to do it today.
Thank you. Which segues into what I was going to, the comments I'm going to make. The first one being that, of course, concern about levies or people pay attention. They want to know what exactly their tax dollars are going for. And in this particular situation, the county already had a debt levy, and we are paying that off from a previous bonding for roads. And so this has been calculated in that taxpayers will not see a difference in their debt service levy going forward, because we are bonding within the same couple of cents for that. It's a new levy, but they will notice it as a kind of a continuation of that item on their tax bill. And then you mentioned the fact that this is for economic development. And in the discussions, that was during our secondary road workshop, we really narrowed in on that. And these areas of road to be paved are behind Lincoln Way and the new Verbio plant there on 220th, and then to extend University Avenue down to the Kelly Blacktop. And University Avenue is, of course, what goes right by the ISU Research Park. We also are doing sharing a cost load in Huxley for paving up to their sky, blue sky, or yeah, Commons Research Park, or Industrial Park, sorry. And there is a bit of a paving project that will be shared with Story City to access a new housing development of about 50 or more homes. So we're incorporating, because housing is in fact economic development. And then there is a bridge in the mix that has to be done that is incorporated into accessing economic development. With that, I'll end, and I'll turn to Supervisor Perkins if she'd like to say anything else.
No, I would move adoption of Resolution 1993.
I would second. Any further discussion? Perkins?
Aye.
Olson? Aye. And with that, we have the resolution to move forward to add that and include it in our budget.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming up, Bob. Appreciate it. Good to see you again. Resolution 1918, Fiscal Year Appropriation Amendment, and Deputy Auditor Mark is joining us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So what you have in front of you is appropriation amendment for the departments that have not been 100% appropriated for just the salary line items at this point. Resolution 1936, which was the most recent one I appropriated 100% of the budget for the elected officials, but 95% of the departments. This resolution appropriates payroll for those departments so that we can get to only amend the payroll coming in at April or May. I can run through them if you'd like, or you can read, I'm sure. The one thing I might add is 2.4 is on here. It does not have payroll, but it does have committed funds that YSS accesses. So I want to get appropriated 100% due to the core budget also.
Supervisor Parker, any questions, comments? Okay, and I also have no questions or comments. I'll entertain the motion.
Move adoption resolution 1989.
Second. Supervisor Perkins?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Thank you. Now, John, come on up here. You're going to talk to us about some windows today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, we just happened to be
this tax stairwell. The nose is warm this summer, it's lost its gas, a lot of the windows are falling. Now, as far as I know, none of them are leaking.
The quote here I see is the $10,571.17 for the estimate there. And that, does that seem reasonable to you?
Yeah, I mean, we're talking probably over half of the window in that one section, so.
Okay. Supervisor Merkin?
No questions.
In that case, I don't have any more for you. If it's lost its efficiency, there are problems down the road anyway. So I entertain that motion.
I would move to file approval of the window replacement as listed.
I second. Merkin?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Thank you. Next item is discussion and consideration of jurisdiction agreement for designated Iowa Bayou Management, off-premise sign management, and sign installation and maintenance with the Iowa Department of Transportation. And Darren Boone is up here now to speak to us about this.
Story County is at the crossroads of the Jefferson Highway and the Lincoln Highway. I think it was about 5 years ago that UT designated some byways in the state, and with that designation came some state funding to sign these byways. And we worked with them and signed a similar agreement for the Lincoln Highway back then. And we worked with the DOT to sign those. Signs look something similar to that for Lincoln Highway, and this would be the Jefferson Highway signs. So really all this is asking is that we work with the DOT. The DOT pays for the signs. We kind of help them locate where the signs should go and help them install them, but beyond that, if they get damaged, the DOT does all the repairs to the signs in the future as well. So we're not asking a lot of the county. I would comment the Jefferson Highway in Story County is a bit unique, but this would be hard to see, but there's an actual loop. One goes up Highway 69 into Ames, and the other one takes a kind of a strange route through Cambridge and then goes on gravel roads and then up through Shipley and into the Davis. There's an actually a loop in Story County. So it's somewhat unique, but there's a little concern. We'll have some signs out in little areas. They tend to get used for target practice and stolen, so we'll have to keep an eye on those signs a little bit more than the rest. But just kind of wanted to point out the uniqueness of the Jefferson Highway there. That's basically it. They're just asking for our assistance to help them pay for the business.
Okay. Any questions?
No.
None for me either. So I must get my entertain motion.
I move approval of the jurisdictional agreement with the Iowa Department of Transportation for the Iowa Bayou Sponsors.
I second. Supervisor Merkin?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Thank you, Darren. And you're going to talk to us about the next item also.
Yeah, this is an agreement with the city of Huxley, and it's a good follow-up to the bonding discussion. It was one of the project was the payment of 560 of South Huxley down to Highway 210. So this agreement would allow us to work with the city just so they could start the process of hiring a consultant to design this paving project. Also, from our last five-year program discussion, we discussed the limitation we're going to put on that of $1 million would be the max the county would put towards that. So that was incorporated in this latest update to the agreement. The city would like to let that about a year from now, so they'd like to get going with the design. It's going to take some railway purchasing, so we need to be working on that. So, any other questions about the agreement?
Any estimate of the total project cost, or is it assumed they do a guess?
They have talked to the consultant, and just a rough upfront estimate could be upwards of $2.5 million. Was the high they thought at this point.
And they understand we're putting $1 million.
I've indicated to them they've been made aware of.
I was just the other day where we were on this.
I don't have any questions. We had pretty thorough discussion during the 5 minutes. So I'm going to entertain that motion again.
I will move approval of resolution 1976-28 agreement for grading and reviewing of high school students.
Second. Supervisor Birkin.
Aye.
Olson. Aye. Thank you, Darren.
Thank you.
Now we're inviting John back up. You're going to give us that facilities management report. When is it? Did you read that?
Well, as you can see from the outline, we're pretty busy. Personally, if I actually had another month like last year.
Just, your staff has done a wonderful job of keeping our sidewalks safe and our parking lots flat. And thank you, because I know it's hard to get out there time after time after time. It turns out that that's not going to be a viable option for us, most probably. As we had the discussion, we had discussed before that they are doing some investigation about the capacity on their system, especially with heavy rains, et cetera. But then it came up almost as a sideline that from the very beginning they had said that the one thing they would insist upon is that the county put in a bike trail from and Craig Myers and I just looked at each other. Later Mike Cox told Craig and I that they had brought it up before, but it was brought up in a joking manner. And so in fact, when it came up last night, I laughed and I said, oh come on, you've heard of available and you're teasing me. And then they said, no, this has been the one requirement of all of us. That's an estimated $1.5 million project on top of what it would take us to go ahead and pay to run into that sewer line, plus other items, you know, that we've already got out. So Mike and already has talked to Margaret
James, who is our environmental specialist, director of environmental health, about wastewater systems. This is very preliminary, and Mike will be back next week with a report for the board about what he and Margaret have begun talking about for alternates on choices. Way to go. No decisions have been made. It's just that we're talking about if going with them, there are multiple layers of issues that would need to be resolved in addition to funding, including who gets pushed out of the way to build that particular trail. So as a result, Mike has a very rough estimate if we went with an Advantix system or something similar. So I would like to raise the estimated amount in the CIP plan for the Hickory Grove sewer project, which we're calling it, to $825,000. Of that, right now, and once again, the board needs to discuss this next week as a full board, but that would be still $450,000 out of conservation reserve, and then the other $375,000 estimate, most likely from general fund. So that's a change. I feel that we now have enough information to shove that estimate in there.
Let me be clear on what you said.
Mm-hmm.
The city said they would consider us hooking up to their septic system if we built a bike trail.
They said that when the discussion started 3 years ago or whenever the first discussion, they said that had been a condition of theirs all along. And all the discussions afterwards have been related to their capacity issues and them needing to both get worked on and to get completely the video survey of the system. So we've been working with them this whole time, and Supervisor Chitty, who is former Supervisor Chitty, was the lead contact on this, and that's something that I guess was put to the background because there was so much emphasis on the problems they had with their sanitary sewer system. And so it never was conveyed, I believe, to the previous board that was actually the number one bottom line condition.
But let me go back and rephrase my question. Yes. Maybe a yes or no.
Okay, yes. Sure. Yeah.
Did they say if the county builds a $1.5 million bike trail, we will allow you to hook up to our sewer?
Yes. Well, they said if we don't have to build it itself. There are multi-conditions here. It's just a new one can add it.
That's
what you're asking. No.
You answered my question.
Right.
So yeah. It's not really a yes if you do this, we'll do that, because there are other considerations besides that they have to look at because of their capacity.
Correct. Yes.
So you're just reporting this was another thing that was brought up.
This was another thing that was brought up, but it was brought up as a bottom line, regardless of what we might help them in paying for a new cell or whatever. Yeah, so
when will they know? When will they have an idea? When will they have a bottom line on what their new system, if they needed it, would cost?
Minimum would be late spring into early summer. And Mike Cox has already talked to, yes, that's why when Mike comes to give the whole report, but Mike has already talked to the water utility out there, and we of course are moving forward with all of our repairs. We are on target to basically have the improvements and the lake hopefully refilled and ready to hook up or have a new system to be in use by June of 2020. That's our target date. If we can develop a contract with the city by June 1st of this year. So that's the target date for the water utility getting ready to go. They're on board. We can have everything done, and we can be finished by June 2020 with our Hickory Grove improvements. if they're ready to go June 1 of 2019. They're not sure they're gonna be ready to go June 1 of 2019. They said, we'll keep you informed, but that condition, this new with the trail, does not appear to be going away. So we let them know, as I said, Mike and I let them know that the county was gonna start seriously looking at other options. And Mike put some pencil to the paper even before we went out. And then he brought this in this morning and left it on my desk. And I said, give us a really rough estimate about now, where are we, about what it would cost us to do if we just went ahead and did like the sanitary sewer, or sorry, to do like the septic option out there, septic tanks in addition to our current one. And this is what he gave to me. So that's our baseline here about what it could cost us, and everything else is probably on top.
And we have nothing in there right now for septic.
Correct. It was the 450. The amount of money that was in there is just kind of for our lagoon, and then we calculated there would be, Mike has basically 750,000 total, so another 300,000 if we were able to go and hook up to their sewer down at Twin Acres. That's where that location, and they actually, their sewer does run under 30 highway 30. So we've never put in that 700, that other 300,000 in there, because I believe Supervisor Sanders was the one who said, well, let's don't add it in yet, we don't know. We now know at least what the baseline for us is going to be, and that is going to be about $825,000 for us to consider options that don't include the cities of Cole.
Sounds like we need to receive the equipment.
Pardon?
Sounds like we put it in.
That is what I'm proposing today, is that we go ahead and add that.
And so it would be fiscal 20?
Yes, this is all in fiscal
20. And where again the amount?
825. And the amount is 675 to 836. So let's put 825 in there.
So for clarification, is this also is what Mike's amount does not? Does that include the expansion?
Yes.
The service to lodge into the south side of the park as well?
Well, that includes expansion in the RV area, and I believe the lodge, but we would have to ask them if it went south of the park, because what it's considering is as they go around and do separate, maybe put in standalone septic for some of the other locations. And with that, Mike will be here next week to do a better explanation on giving you a broad overview here.
Given that this is coming up today, we would more prefer that we not have the CIP for official action on this Tuesday's agenda and the following
week. I'm going to look at Lisa Markley about, with the addition here, that changes some of your numbers, but only out of the reserve, correct? The new fund balance, maybe? I mean, if we pull it out of the general.
It would change the expenses that have been published, which, as we've all talked about numerous times, we will end up amending in July anyway to find, or to pull in the dollars we didn't end up spending in 2019. to a different amount and different resources. We wouldn't change the budget at this point in time. So if we want to hold off on this another week, it's not going to make or break anything.
Okay.
I would be hesitant to change the budget at this point anyway, just because of the fact that, obviously there's a lot of unknowns in the public hearing for next week. To set the budget, because you're right, it's coming out of, this part's already budgeted, and you know, $375 will come out of general fund, which will be on any fund balance. So is it, it's coming out of.
So that, Lisa, seems to go along with your, kind of your thoughts there, Lynn, that let's go ahead and deal with this after we get the budget published. So that we've got consistent numbers, and then we have to really change later. And you're right, it is very preliminary here. That's just getting the information last night. It was a surprise to Craig Myers and I to have heard about the trail being an absolute, this is what we really want.
But that's not really, that doesn't really change things. I mean, the fact is that they are not going to have their work done.
Correct, there are so many variables.
By the time we need to know, not to, for
we would
timeline.
Correct, we would miss then most likely the June 1st, 2019 deadline from Central Iowa Water, which now has another name.
So do we need a motion?
And I'm going to look back here, and Leanne, with you having worked with the CIP for many years, we're not doing anything today, and according also to Lisa's recommendation. So instead, we don't even have anything to do today until the night.
It's just suggested to me that we could give staff direction at this point.
Direction is to come back then with those numbers in on the 19th. Are you comfortable understanding your direction? And final remarks, any other thoughts? This is for us, for the budget goes. All right.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, we're going to go now to public comment number two. We're back on the CIP or public
comment? Nope. Item's not on the agenda. So just as Commissioner of Elections, I wanted to remind anyone that's here or listening that there's an election in Roland today. Polls are open until 8 p.m. It is for general obligation bond about the pool, but there's also a vacancy. Three people running in one seat on the city council. So looks like we'll have a good turnout today, and everyone from Roland, go vote.
Okay. Thank you. Liaison assignments, comments, etc. Supervisor Merkin.
I have a few comments. The first one is, facilities, as you said, has done a great job of keeping our sidewalks, our pavement, everything, and our buildings warm. So thank them for all this time. I would also like to thank the engineer's office for a couple things. The first one is, as I've gone around the county this week, I've asked people, I just said, hey, how are the roads? People I know live out in the county, they said, the roads are great. The county road crew is doing a great job. So and I've seen that too, so I wanted to say, please pass that on, that everybody seems to be extremely happy about the job you've done and understanding of difficulties. The other one is, I would like to thank both the engineer's office and the sheriff's office for helping me deal with a constituent complaint that came up about something that had happened on the road, and helping somebody understand why the county had to tow a vehicle that otherwise might have had some very bad things happen to it. So I appreciated that. We got back to a constituent the same day I received the concern from that person, and he wrote back to me and said, we have great staff out there doing a great job, and I'm thankful to understand him on that. This is in the legislature funnel week. The first, where bills have to come out of subcommittee in the or as a committee. I'm just reading, there's so many funnels. on committee in the same house, yes. So Friday's gone, we, there's a couple bills we've been funneling. One of them is House File 216, which I don't know if you've heard about, but would severely limit county and state government in acquiring lands for conservation purposes. I did hear yesterday on the radio that Rob Bacon, who's the chair of the House Natural Resources Committee, said they had had a hearing. There had been one group that was in favor of this bill, and there were numerous groups and numerous people who were speaking against the bill. He was saying he wasn't sure if that bill was going to come out of the committee, but if you care about conservation and care about getting, our ability to take sensitive lands, put them into conservation use, and just in terms of economic development, continuing to develop the parks, the recreation we have in this county, I'd suggest maybe you get in touch with him and see your opposition House File 216.
It's 542. Thank you, because
I was
216 concerns us too.
216 also concerns us.
Right, okay, thank you.
Thanks for that. I was just looking at this and saying, that's not right. 216 is one that would change how the county's county supervisors were constituted and the supervisors were elected. And in counties with over 60,000 population, it would require Plan 3, which is electing supervisors by districts.
Just to let you know, I was going to say in my updates that last year when this came up, Supervisor Sanders sent a communication. It was not voted on by the board to send first, but he sent a communication. And I was going to send communication under my name only, because I'm going to vote for him on the agenda. And you're free to do that too to our local legislators about that.
I've also done so. That one basically would take that decision away from the county, the constituents and the county, the voters in the county about how they want their county government representing them. So those two bills we're hoping don't go in.
There is a companion bill to 5.2. It's a Senate Study Bill 1221. And that one focuses more upon, it's my understanding, with the granting of land from families, etc. So it's a little different emphasis. But we had six members of our conservation staff down lobbying. It was two of our conservation board members down there lobbying. There could not get everybody in the room. They think people came from Fraser County, either conservation board.
I received lots of emails about and there's also something I saw in the Tribune today that I know a little bit about. Prairie Rivers of Iowa has received a Conservation Partners grant from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. We're going to be reaching out to farmers and landowners in Story County to assist in improving water quality and wildlife habitat around the area. They're going to be working with lots of other organizations on this. I think this is the first. We've seen a lot of water quality initiatives and pollinator. This is the first one I've seen, particularly about wildlife habitat. So that is bringing some more options about how private landowners can help improving our water quality and our wildlife situation. So it's in. Posted March 4th in the Tribune, so people might want to look at that if they are interested in getting hold of Prairie Rivers and finding out more about that.
Thank you. I'm just going to keep it short here. The board for HERTA, which provides our bus service and public transit service outside of Ames and also in 600 counties. The board voted on Monday morning to accept notice from the agency, the contractor that provides bus service in Dallas County, that contractor will no longer provide service as of March 31st of this year. The board, HERTA board, had
previously voted to end contractor relationships. As of July 1, the Dallas County situation is volatile, and as a result, the agency just said we are going to be done. And we could have enforced the contract of a 90-day notice. We didn't see any upside to doing that and a lot of risk involved. So I will give you updates. We don't anticipate that there will be any drain or production of service in Story County or the other counties. We already, of course, transitioned boom last year and learned a lot from that. So, but if you hear anything out there, that is what's happening. And then Madison County will transition to direct service from the first day on July 1st. And that's all I've got. We've got many other updates, but they can, they'll go and run their natural course. So, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
And thank you, everybody.
Thank you.